He's looking at okay, I will try to present you some examples of climate impact assessment applied to Earth observation. So of course there has been many other climate impact assessments, so I will focus on the one that that are based on satellite observations. So to begin this talk, I thought we were going to talk about climate, so a very good indicator of warming of our climate is of course air temperature, but a very important driver into this is the release of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere and the increase in this carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. And so this is one of the latest records from September 19 of this year. So we are around 400 ppm. So we reached that high value, I think, the first time maybe around May 2013, and so I think ever since we quite above it, we get quite close to it, but for some part of the seasonal cycle in the CO2 we get a little bit further up. So this is based on the Mauna Loa time series, so it's a fixed time series, it's taking in situ measurements of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. And more recently, there has been a few sensors that have been launched, satellite sensors, that have been launched to space and which are capable of getting some information on the concentration of carbon dioxide from space. And so ESA has launched this climate change initiative. So Shubha presented the climate change initiative for ocean color. There has been other variables which are called essential climate variables that have been that are being investigated under this program, and this includes greenhouse gas emission. And so under this greenhouse gas emission CCI project, they are trying to merge observations of carbon dioxide, and this is just an example for the period, I think, from 2002 till 2013. Emissions. So a little bit more about this ESA climate change initiative. So as part of the Global Climate Observing System, so GCOS, they identified around 50 essential climate variables to support the work of, for instance, the IPCC, so the Intergovernmental Panel for Climate Change, and also the work from the United Nations framework for the Convention on Climate Change. And among those 50 essential climate variables, ESA, through the Climate Change Initiative Program, has been looking or funding a project to look at 13, to address 13 ECVs, to measure 13 ECVs from space. So these include for the atmosphere, we have ozone, greenhouse gases, I've just shown an example from that project, cloud and aerosols. On the ocean, ECVs from the ocean, we have sea ice, SST, ocean color, and sea level. And from land, they're looking at glaciers, land cover, soil moisture, fire, and ice sheets in the Antarctic. So I will give you just four examples from these four ocean ECVs. So we start with a sea surface temperature time series. So similarly as for ocean color, there has been a project to merge satellite observation that are looking at sea surface temperatures. And now we have a complete and continuous record, bias corrected, since 1991 for SST based on satellite observations. We see an increase in sea surface temperature in that graph ever since. Here is a global mean sea level budget. So here we have a record. On this graph, it only starts in 2003, but in actual fact, the CCI sea level time record starts, I think, 1993 till present. And so we see here the increase in sea level over time. And so sea level is actually a contribution both from land ice, which are melting, and also ocean thermal expansion. So if you have a warming of the ocean temperature, then you also get an increase and expansion of the space that it takes, and then it rises the sea level. So sea level is a very important essential climate variable. I mean, a large proportion of the population lives by the coast. So if sea level increases, then this population are at risk of repeated flooding, permanent submersion. If you also increase the sea level, then you might get more erosion of the cliffs of the, any beach. You might also increase saline estuaries if you have more seawater coming into these estuaries, and salt contamination of groundwater that we might be using for drinking water, for instance. Another of this ocean essential climate variable also measure. Oh, sorry, tell me, you have a question.
Well, I just wanted to quickly ask.
Yeah.
Sea surface temperature from satellite.
Yes.
How is that? Is there a simple way of saying how you do that?
It's through infrared, so I'm not at all a specialist. Bob would be much better. Shuba, do you want to say a word on this
before I say? But it is true. It's from the thermal infrared region, quite far out in the thermal
wave bands. Yeah.
Infrared region. You know that every body that's not at absolute zero has some emission, thermal emission, depending on the temperature. And if you look at the Earth as a whole, its emission is peaking in somewhere in the thermal infrared. So these sensors are designed to look at the emissions at that wavelength from the sea. They also have similar problems in the sense that you have to correct for the influence of the atmosphere, the clouds, everything interfering with what's coming from the ocean. So they also go through convoluted procedures to correct for things. But so to do that, they look at multiple wavelengths in the thermal infrared, and they have algorithms to correct for this effect and that effect. But ultimately what you get is what is called the skin temperature. Very, very thin layer from the surface. That's what you are getting from the satellite. So unlike ocean color, which detects whose signal comes from a finite layer in the ocean, which can be about 10 meters or more thereabouts, this is just a skin from the surface.
Okay, all right. Okay, and then sea ice, also measured from satellite sensors. So here are just some examples of seasonal cycles in sea ice. So we can't see too well, but 2017 is in red. So it's this one here. And 2012 is in this turquoise blue. So it's up here. And then we had the lowest sea ice extent in September 2012. So that was actually a sad record, because it was a record, but for very low sea ice cover. Okay, and then ocean color is another of these ECVs. So it's actually the only biological ECV. Other ECVs are looking at physical variable. So ocean color is a biological variable looking at the marine ecosystem. And so this is a figure presented by Bob a few days ago, where he shows here the chlorophyll concentration in red, and the multivariate ENSO index. Dio has mentioned about it. I will explain a little bit more after. And here is again chlorophyll, total chlorophyll, from CCI, and the IOD, Indian Ocean Dipole Mode Index. And I will explain in a few slides how this index is calculated. What's interesting to see is that phytoplankton is very tightly coupled with the environmental condition. It responds actually within a few hours or within few days to changes in the environmental condition. So it's actually a very good indicator of what's happening in the ocean, also in terms of the physics. If the phytoplankton is changing, it's because the physics is changing. Okay, so before I go any further, I mean, I felt it was quite important to differentiate between climate change and climate variability. You hear both words. Maybe I shouldn't have put the slide. I should have actually asked you first, but now the answers are here, or actually some answers. Maybe you disagree, maybe you have something to complement. But so climate variability is actually looking at short-term changes within a few years. And we're looking at rises and falls above and below a certain mean state. So this is the climate variability. Climate change is we're looking at something on much longer timescales, so decadal to centennial timescales. And this is actually looking at a persistent rise or persistent fall in the mean state, so the mean state of the climate, or actually or its variability. Perhaps at some point the climate becomes much more variable and this becomes persistent. So this is also another form of change in climate change. And when we investigating changes in climate, quite often we might use a reference period. Especially it becomes very useful when we are estimating climate indices, as I will define in a couple of slides. And this reference period has been advised by the World WMO, World Meteorological Organization, to be around 30 years. So at present, a common time period that we are using is usually between 1960 to 1980. So you might say, okay, but so what do we do for ocean color? I mean, ocean color started in 1997, okay, until present, so we are nearly reaching 20 years. So if we look at this definition, then we don't even have a reference period. But okay, we can look at influence of climate through different approaches. So, okay, multi-decadal changes. So before the CCI project, I forgot to mention that this project started around 2010. It was the first project funded, and then a few more started 2012, and ever since it's been running. So it's quite a long-term effort. I mean, it's already 5 or 7 years effort. So it's a lot of work to actually merge the information from the different sensors. So prior to CCI era, I would say, okay, there had been some effort to merge information from different satellites. So the first satellite I mentioned, it was a coastal zone color scanner. It was operational between 1978 and 1986. And then the second major ocean color sensor was SeaWIF, which was operational 1997 to 2010. So you see that actually they didn't overlap. There was a long interruption of about 9 years between the two. And we didn't have any observations. So there has been a number of approaches to actually try to merge the observation. So one of them has been led by a team from Villefranche in south of France, where they actually, they applied the same chlorophyll retrieval algorithm using the same, almost the same wavebound between CZCS and CWIF. So this was this effort. There has been an effort looking at trying to involve in situ observation into the merging process to kind of recalibrate and correct for inter-sensor bias. So this was done by Greg and Conright. There has been also Dio presented an approach yesterday, I think it was. You actually showed with the CPR data a different approach, so using in-situ observation to try to bridge both archives. And I also mentioned a few days ago the approach looking at relative patterns in the chlorophyll signal, so looking, for instance, at the duration of the bloom or timing of the bloom, and estimating actually because this satellite, the sensor was not switched on all the time, so you had a lot of gaps. So I also showed you how to assess the influence of the gaps in this time series. So I will show you some of the results from this approach. So here is a very nice paper by Elodie Martinez who looked at both chlorophyll concentration from seaweed and chlorophyll concentration during the CZTS time record. So they have applied the method of Antoine et al. They applied the same chlorophyll retrieval algorithm and say, okay, it should be comparable. So now they're looking at their ratio. And so in some region, they see increases in chlorophyll concentration. Other regions, they find decreases in chlorophyll concentration between the two periods. And they try to relate this information with the changes in SST. So the bottom map shows you the difference between the period, more recent period, 1998 to 2002, minus the period 1979 to 1983. And so here you see in blue region where you had decrease in sea surface temperature and region where you have increase in sea surface temperature. And so, okay, they say, well, so to try to better understand, then they change the representation. And if you only look at the upper figure, you see, for instance, here in this turquoise blue, shows region where you have decrease in sea surface temperature and increase in chlorophyll. While yellow region, it's the opposite. It's region where you have increase in SST and decrease in chlorophyll concentration. So I think it's a nice way to represent the changes. And you also have region where you have both enhanced SST and enhanced chlorophyll, or increased SST and enhanced chlorophyll, or decrease of SST and decrease of chlorophyll. I will explain in a couple of slides potential different mechanisms as to why sometimes when SST decreases, you might get an increase in chlorophyll concentration. So this is for the period that compares the CZCS era and the beginning of the CWIF era. And she also did another analysis, this time only looking at data from the CWIF sensor. And here she's looking at changes during the period 1999 to 2004. And so what do you see? Can someone explain to me? It's pretty straightforward, but it's the opposite, yes. So it's the opposite. You have actually, where you had a decrease in SST, you actually have an increase in SST. And the chlorophyll is responding in the same way. If you increase SST, you decrease chlorophyll. While in that region, it's the opposite. So actually, this makes you think quite a lot. Personally, I think it's quite important, depending on the period that you're looking at, and you might have increase in SST or decrease in SST, and then your chlorophyll will respond very differently. So when you're actually going to be looking at trend calculations, just by looking at different periods, you might not get the same response. And so this gets us back here. Actually, if you're looking during this period, just this couple of years, maybe you would see a decrease in the chlorophyll concentration. But if you're looking starting, let's say, from this year, then maybe you would say, we have an increase in chlorophyll concentration. Okay. So, next slide. Okay, trends analysis. So there has been a lot of effort towards this since beginning, well, not quite the beginning, but ever since we have had ocean color observation. So here are a summary of a few efforts. They are actually summarized in a paper by Greg and Russo, 2014. And so actually you see, so in blue it tells you that you had an increase or decrease in chlorophyll concentration, red an increase in chlorophyll concentration. And so what do you see on these figures? What is there anything that strikes you or something? Do you find that we observe the same trends between all sources? What could be the reason why we have differences or why we don't have differences? Can you actually read the years or just about? It's difficult to read. Okay, but so just looking at the colors, so they only show, of course, in white it's where it's not significant. The region in color is where it is significant. So this period is SAT sensor CWIF, so from 1998 till 2003. Here we're looking at 1997 till 2007. Here we're looking 1997 to 2007. So these two are potentially the same years. Here we're looking at 1997 to 2010, And here we're looking at 1998 to 2012. And this one is a merged product between CWIF and MODIS. As soon as you start adding or removing a few years, your entire trend is changing. So this is very, very important to bear in mind. And I will explain in the next few slides a potential reason as to why it changes so much between years. Okay, so we can't read. On my computer we can, but here we should be able to read better because it's larger, but it's a little bit blurry. So, but okay, here they just you can find it in the paper. I will provide a full reference, but they give here information on the data that they use, their resolution, on the resolution of the analysis, whether it was on annual mean or monthly mean. So okay, these are other sources of variation. Whether they did some gap filling or they didn't, whether they log transformed the data or they didn't, whether they corrected the bias for the data. So in this actual work that Greg and Russo did, so they bias corrected, they also used data simulation technique that Stefano presented you yesterday. Here is a type of method that they applied. So most of them looked at linear regressions. One group, Ventrepot and Melin, looked at census X11 procedure. So they're actually fitting the time series to some kind of a model that will include the seasonal cycle, the trend, and some residual variability. So different method, different approach. Another more recent work by Craig et al, 2017, so they still this time they are looking at the period from 1998 to 2015, so very long time record. Here is total chlorophyll over that period. So they are merging different products, CWIF, MODIS, and VIRS, and also using an assimilation model, so the NOBM, NASA Ocean Biogeochemistry model. I think Stefano presented it yesterday. And they not only looked at trends in chlorophyll, but using their model output that assimilates chlorophyll, they looked at trends in diatoms, in cyanobacteria, and in chlorophytes over that period. So here are some of their results, always expressed in a percentage of change per year. So you see in general maybe a decrease in diatoms in the northern Pacific, potential some increase in the Southern Ocean, increase in cyanobacteria. They're quite remarkable in the Indian Ocean, and a decrease in chlorophytes also in the Indian Ocean. Another approach to trend analysis. This was not necessarily expected when I did the work, but so this is the example of the trends from Ventrepot and Melin, looking at the period 1997 till 2007. And during my PhD, I did this work on the phenology globally. And so I could estimate for every year what would be the duration of the growing period. So the duration here. And actually, when I calculated the simple trend, I found it's actually showing a similar trend as with the chlorophyll values. And so this is also another approach to look at trends. You can also do, of course, trends in phenological variables. So we find an apparent decrease during that period, during that decade, in chlorophyll and duration. But really, what is the influence of short-term climate variability into this signal? So here is just the Ocean Color Climate Change Initiative, so merging four sensors, and now also the three sensors, and now ALSI sensor from Sentinel-3. And here are some results based on the OCCCI data. So here again, very interesting. I find it, I think this time we can read better. You see clearly, depending on the period that you're looking at, the signal can be complete opposite. So we have to be very careful when we are talking about trends. You have to remember that it's very sensitive to the period that you're looking at. And okay, one possible reason as to why this is. So this is a figure that Bob showed with the MEI index, multivariate ENSO index, and the OCCCI on top of it. So you see that it follows very strongly. And you actually notice, maybe, or you didn't notice, so MEI is here on the on this axis from minus 4 to plus 4. Okay, and here on the on this y-axis, it's a chlorophyll, and maybe you notice that it's actually a reversed axis. So negative anomalies are here, and positive anomalies are here. So the actual relationship is actually inversed. And so if you look during the period 1998 till here, if you get the inverse of this, then you, instead of an increase, you would see a decrease, which is what you see. So multivariate ENSO index, El Niño, Southern Oscillation. So ENSO is one of the dominant modes of climate variability on the Earth system. So it will have an influence in the equatorial Pacific, where it's pretty much rooted, but it will also have an influence globally. And so we see here very clearly, during that period, potentially it could be indeed a negative trend if we take the opposite. And if we start in 2002, we might be around here until 2011. Okay, indeed, if we take the reverse, so here we see a decrease, so if we take the reverse, potentially we have an increase. So this is one of the potential explanations as to why it's so sensitive. And the Indian Ocean, you see also very different trends depending on the two periods. And actually, if you had seen before, usually when you have a positive ENSO index, you also have a positive IOD. So they follow each other quite closely. So actually, the same, pretty much same happen between the two. So I will explain about IOD in the next slide. So here was to show one of the very remarkable work from CCI. So now we have this super long time record actually updated until present. And here is just to show you the trend over that entire time period. I think it's to me it's very, very, very good. Okay, so climate indices. So in order to explain a little bit of the variability in the system that you're looking at and how phytoplankton respond to the variability, to this climate variability, well, we can use some climate indices. So this can be regional climate indices or like El Niño. So these climate indices can actually give you information on the regional climate, but also sometimes this regional climate through teleconnection mechanism can have repercussion all around the planet, like with the El Niño. So just a definition, so a climate index is a simple diagnostic quantity that you can use to characterize the state of your climate system or to characterize changes in your climate system. So a variety of methods have been developed and used. So it could either be you select a specific station where you're going to take, for instance, some SST measurement or sea level pressure measurement. You can use a grid point or regional average data. We'll see some example of this. And very often, actually, those climate indices are estimated based on empirical orthogonal function. So it's like a principal component analysis. So as I mentioned before, very often they rely on a climate-based period. So this about 30 years time period, which will be used as a reference period, reference mean in those climates. And so most of the time, the most commonly used climate indices would be the El Niño Southern Oscillation, the Indian Ocean Dipole. So this one is rooted in the equatorial Pacific. Indian Ocean Dipole Mode Index is looking at a gradient of SST in the Indian Ocean region. The North Atlantic Oscillation, so Dionysios presented an example with ENEO yesterday. Pacific Decadal Oscillation, so ENEO is based on changes in sea level pressure between, I think, Azores in Portugal and Iceland. And it's looking more at more decadal oscillation. Pacific Decadal Oscillation, PDO, is looking at, it's defined by looking at changes in sea surface temperature north of 20 degrees north in the Pacific Ocean. This is again reflecting like decadal, more decadal variability. Southern annular mode, I think it's looking at changes in zonal pressure between two different regions in the southern hemisphere, I think between around 45 degrees south and 60 degrees south. And the southern oscillation index, looking at sea level pressure, I think between Tahiti and Darwin in Australia. So different definitions, but they will tell you information on the regional climate variability. So Indian Ocean Dipole Mode Index, I explain a little bit more because I will give some example. In the next few slides, I will give you a few examples related to the Indian Ocean Dipole Mode Index, and then we'll look at El Nino. And so this will be for the tropical and tropics and subtropics regions. And then I'll move on to higher latitude with one example in the Arctic. But you'll have to keep up because it's a few slides on the tropics and subtropics. So IODE is a coupled ocean atmosphere phenomenon. And it's defined actually as a gradient in sea surface temperature between the eastern and western side of the Indian Ocean. So in a neutral phase, you have, so it's blowing to the east, so eastward winds that are pushing a little bit. So this is a negative phase, but in neutral mode, this is a little bit the same that is happening, but not so strong. So they are pushing a little bit the warm water towards the east of the Indian Ocean. And so you have warm water there, you create convection, so more moisture in the air. And so you get more precipitation in that area and a little bit of upwelling. So this is reinforced during the negative mode of the IOD. And during the positive phase, which is often associated with the positive phase of El Nino, you get the reverse effect. Actually, you get, so the wind is blowing towards the west, so you get all the warm water gets pushed up off the east coast of Africa. You get warm water, warm air, more moisture in that region, and you have upwelling that is happening over the west coast of Indonesia, and you have cooler water there and drier conditions. So this will influence, of course, precipitations and also what's happening in the ocean. So how is the phytoplankton responding to this? So Bob did a very nice study on this. He actually show you here the three conditions that I just described. I had forgotten that it was coming up, okay. So in October 1997, so around here, we have a positive dipole mode index. So when it is in positive condition, you get a wetter condition and warmer water in that region. So you have a little bit of downwelling and more upwelling here. In October 1998, so this was 1997, 1998, we had a negative MEI, so reverse effect. You get the water that is pushed up towards, warm water pushed up towards Indonesia, and you get more upwelling on the east coast of Africa. You get a wetter condition over Indonesia, and this is a neutral condition, an example in October 2001. So it's quite similar to the negative condition, but I mean, much less strong. And so what happens in the phytoplankton? So here is for total chlorophyll. So it's a correlation or regression analysis between total chlorophyll and the DMEI index over that period, over these 11 years. And we see in some region, when we have a positive DMEI, so in that case, we have enhanced upwelling here. Well, we have also enhanced chlorophyll concentration. It makes sense. You bring up nutrients from deeper water, so you get enhanced chlorophyll. And when we have still positive DMEI, we get downwelling in that region, a pickup of warm water, so we have a decrease in total chlorophyll concentration. And so in terms of the size structure, what's happening? So the micro phytoplankton is responding very much like total chlorophyll. Same for the nano phytoplankton, but the pico phytoplankton is the opposite effect. So they tend to, during a positive phase of the MEI, they are more successful, or you get more of the very small phytoplankton over the east coast of Africa and a few were over the west coast of Indonesia. Okay. So now I move on to the El Niño Southern Oscillation. So far I haven't really explained what is El Niño. So El Niño is actually, this is the oceanic component in this El Niño Southern Oscillation. It's again ocean atmosphere coupled system or phenomenon. So El Niño is actually referring to the ocean component and the Southern Oscillation is referring to the atmospheric component. So during an El Niño, you tend to have maximum anomalies of warming of sea surface temperature in the equatorial Pacific that will happen around the eastern side of the Pacific, so of the coast of Peru. And you would get a cooler temperature of this region. So this is because you have the wind that will be blowing towards the east, so the trade winds, they will be piling up warm waters towards the coast of South America. And so you block upwelling in that region, you actually maybe get some downwelling, and you would expect to have a decrease in phytoplankton concentration in that region. So, in terms of seasonality, what it's looking like, when is it peaking, this anomalous warm SST? Well, it will start around May. You would start to have the equatorial Pacific SST will start to warm. Then around July, August, you will get, it's the Indian Ocean SST that might start warming. And by November, December, January sometime, this is when you have the maximum of the warming of the SST. So this is really the period when you will get the most of the strength of this El Niño phenomenon. Is this clear so far? Yes, okay. I'll try to move to the next one. So here is an example though of what happened during the record of the CWIF sensor. So in December 1997, there was an exceptionally strong El Niño event that happened, which brought extremely warm temperature in that region of the equatorial Pacific. And we see we had, almost a very strong, very low phytoplankton growth in that region. The water is very, very dark blue here. We have very, very low concentration. And a few months later, so here is the example for July 1998. So we had the reverse, so the La Niña condition. So during a La Niña condition, we have actually, so the wind are actually strengthened towards the western part of the equatorial Pacific. So they are blowing in that direction. They are pushing the warm water up to here. And then you create conditions for cooler water to come up. So you have very strong upwelling in that region. And it's very, very well characterized here. It was a very strong La Niña in 1998. And so you get cooler SST. Very strong upwelling, which brings a lot of nutrients up to the surface, and you actually see it very beautifully in the CWIF record. You have a very strong, very high chlorophyll concentration during that month. So the phytoplankton responded very, very quickly and very, very strongly to that signal. So this is an example for one particular year. So we just mentioned about the Indian Ocean Dipole, and we mentioned about ENSO. So I mentioned that ENSO, through various teleconnection patterns, it can have, atmospheric teleconnection pattern, it will have an influence on the climate in other regions of the world. And especially in the Indian Ocean, it will also have some influence. So here is an example of a work by Curie et al, who tried to separate the effect from ENSO and IOD on phytoplankton, on chlorophyll concentration in the Indian Ocean. So simply, they applied a method that is called a partial regression analysis. So you do first a regression using the Ninos 3 index. Yeah, before I go further, I put this slide for this reason. So the way that is calculated, the El Niño-Southern oscillation, you might get a Nino index. Maybe you've heard of this. So you've maybe heard of Nino 3 index, Nino 4 index. So this actually corresponds to the region where you take the mean of your sea surface temperature anomalies. So if you take the Nino 3 index, it's here in red. Nino 4, it's more on the central or actually western side of the equatorial Pacific. Nino 1.2 is right in front of the coast of South America, and Nino 3.4 is a much more central region. So it's 3.4 because it takes it overlaps between a box for Nino 4 and the box for Nino 3. Okay, when we talk about multivariate ENSO index, so I show it here. I will go back to the previous slide after. So this MEI index, it contains information not only on SST, but also on a number of variables. It includes information on sea level pressure, zonal and meridional winds, sea surface and air temperature, and total cloudiness. So all these variables are used together based on statistical analysis to create this multivariate ENSO index. So it's a little bit different than the maybe more simple Nino 3 or Nino 4 point, Nino 4 index. And so why did they create this MEI index? Actually, this MEI index takes SST over this entire region. It doesn't take just here or just Nino 3, it takes the entire region. And also for the physical, the other variable like sea level pressure and cloudiness, the wind, it also takes over this entire region. So if any El Niño phenomenon happen in that region, it will be captured by the MEI index. So this is why for us biologists, we've been using it quite a lot, because it will capture any variation related to El Niño in that region. And if something happens here, then you might be seeing a remote influence like Dio showed in his talk. So let me finish on this. So this lady applied partial regression analysis. So she did first a regression of the chlorophyll and Nino 3 index, and then she took the residual out of this, and she also did the same regression with the initial chlorophyll and the DMEI index, and she gets a residual. And then on the residuals, and she does another regression on the residual from the Nino 3 index. She does a regression with the dipole mode index. And then vice versa, when she gets a residual from the dipole mode index, she does another regression using the Nino 3 index. And this is how she extracts the influence from the two. And you see here, we've seen it before, like in the paper of Bob, very enhanced chlorophyll concentration when we have positive IODE, simply because we have upwelling. And we see also the influence of ENSO in that region separately. So I think it's quite an interesting study. If you're interested in this kind of work, it's worth looking at it. Okay, so back to MEI. And so here is an example that Dio has just presented to you. I thought it's quite a very nice example of a remote ENSO effect on the environmental condition and on the phytoplankton, so in the Red Sea. So the Red Sea is not situated in the equatorial Pacific, but yet El Niño can have an influence in that region through different atmospheric teleconnection patterns. Okay, so I thought, so we've heard that it can have some remote effect. So there is many more examples in the literature. I only show a few, but you can find many. Just type MEI and phytoplankton, you will find many examples. Or El Niño and phytoplankton, you will find many examples. So in about maybe a couple of years ago, 2015 until this year, I had a project funded by the European Space Agency, Living Planet Fellowship. Actually, it's an excellent fellowship program. If you are just finishing your PhD or you have a couple of years of postdoc experience, it's a great program to apply to develop applications of satellite observations, not only on ocean color, but on any other sensors. And so one of the motivation for this project that I put together was to characterize the impact of climate on the marine ecosystem. And I actually looked at the climate assessment report from the IPCC that had just come out, and in the chapter on the ocean. So we're looking here at the work from the working group number two. There is working group number one that is assessing the physical state, the influence of the climate on the physical state. And here is working group two is looking at impact, adaptation, and mitigation. So this is where you will find information about the marine ecosystem and maybe how they use ocean color observations to inform this policy. And so in their report, they actually indicated that they have they recognize that they have low confidence in their understanding of how equatorial upwelling system will change in response to El Niño variability. So I thought, okay, this is very important. I had been working on El Niño influence already, and I thought El Niño variability, yes, how can we characterize this? What is it exactly? So I will explain a bit more. So in simple terms, this project looked at used climate index and looked at El Niño variability and its influence on a number of indicators, including chlorophyll, primary production, and phenology. And so another motivation also for this work was that in the literature you can find now for several years this fantastic atlas of El Niño impacts. So here on top is for the period December-February, and at the bottom is June-August. And so you find this impact, so it's always the impact on the physics. So we were able to tell in which region you might have a drought if you have El Niño conditions, or where you will have a very wet conditions if you have an El Niño conditions. And I thought, but we don't have this for the ocean, and especially we don't have this for the marine ecosystem. So how can we inform anyone relying on the ocean resources? What's going to happen? Why don't we have such maps that would inform us? So I thought, okay, this is needed. And now we have ocean color observation. We can have a global view. We have several years of data. And so I thought, okay, let's explore. So and now I will explain to you a little bit more about El Niño variability, also called ENSO diversity, or different flavors of El Niño, if we want to hear different names. So in 1997-1998 was a very strong Eastern Pacific El Niño. So we call it that way because we call it the canonical form of El Niño. It's because the maximum anomalous warming of SST was located really much on the east coast of the equatorial Pacific. But in other years, it's not always like this. More recently, we've observed, and this is a characteristic example, in 2004 and 2005, there was also an anomalous warming of SST in the equatorial Pacific, so it was classified as an El Niño event, but this warming didn't occur right by the coast of South America. It actually occurred much more centrally, near the dateline in the equatorial Pacific. And so, okay, you might say, it just changed. What do we do with it? But actually, the atmospheric circulation associated with this phenomenon, so the southern oscillation associated with this El Niño, varied by quite a lot. So during the normal condition, you have the strong trade winds that are blowing towards the east. And so you get this packing of warm water. You get all the wet conditions in that region. During the Central Pacific El Niño, it's also called the El Niño Modoki. So this was actually the original name proposed by a Japanese colleague, Yamagata, Toshio Yamagata, and his colleague Ashok, who is from India. So they were working together on this. And so they proposed the name Modoki. Modoki in Japanese, it means pseudo. So the pseudo El Niño. So it's not exactly El Niño, but it's quite similar and a little bit different. So the conditions are actually different. During El Niño Modoki, you have trade winds that are blowing both from the east and the west, and you get the packing of warm water in the central part, and this is also where you get all the warmer air and more precipitations. And you see that this will influence, of course, underwater, well, your mixed layer depths and your thermocline. And so in more recent years, the intensity and frequency of this central Pacific El Niño have increased. And there are some projections that this will continue in the future, although this is under debate. So you might think, okay, so my objective was then to try to assess first what was the global impact of canonical El Niño, and also what would be the impact if we have a different type of El Niño, and then like an extreme type where you have more Central Pacific. So I used climate indices again. So this time it's Eastern Pacific El Niño Index, Central Pacific El Niño Index. It's also based on a partial regression analysis and using EOF. So this is developed by this author. And here is an example, but I'm very sorry, we can't see very well. So it's from 1979 till 2015. Here is whether you had El Niño or La Niña event during those years. And at the bottom, just a row below, it's whether it was Eastern Pacific or Central Pacific phenomenon. And here was an ocean color period that I had when I started this project. So it didn't go up to 2015 yet. But we see that just if you just look at the color, we see that we have a couple of El Niño events and a couple of La Niña events. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 events El Niño. And out of these 5 events, actually one was an Eastern Pacific event in 1997. And the next three, or actually next four, were more Central Pacific or unclassified, meaning that it could not be classified as Central Pacific or Eastern Pacific. And here are some examples of the data that we used. So OCCCI, SST CCI, sea level CCI, wind data, primary production from the TIWA project. Shubha mentioned it a couple of days ago. Also precipitation data and surface air temperature data. It's simply based on EOF and partial regression analysis. We account for autocorrelation in our time series when we do the analysis, and we use a simple student t-test. So initially, this work had been developed for the North America air temperature, differentiating the impact of the two types of El Niño on the air temperature in North America. And you see here very different impact. So first, I looked at reproducing this type of analysis. I did it for air temperature, but also for sea surface temperature. And we see that during Eastern Pacific El Niño impact, so we have this characteristic warming on the eastern side and characteristic warming on the central part. But you also see that the impact is maybe stronger in other basins during the Central Pacific El Niño. And actually, if you take the sum of these two impacts, you get something like this. So this is for sea surface temperature. And actually, you find again the MEI impact is very similar. So what does this tell you? But it tells you simply that MEI, the way that this index is calculated, it takes into account, as I said, any El Niño event that is happening in that region. It doesn't allow you to differentiate whether it was more central or eastern type. Okay, and so then I looked at the influence on the biology. So first, chlorophyll. So Eastern Pacific El Niño is very classic. You get very strong decrease in chlorophyll concentration. We also see very strong decrease in the Indian Ocean, eastern part. Central Pacific, well, the decrease is occurring where you have the warming of the SST, so more on the eastern side, or more on the western side than central side. And you get an opposite effect in the Indian Ocean. Primary production, so very similar. And the duration of the phytoplankton growing period. So I couldn't get it for this Eastern Pacific type of El Niño, but simply because the record from CWIF started in September, October. And to estimate the phenology, you need a full annual cycle. And so I could not estimate the impact on the Eastern Pacific. So during that period that I had, I could only characterize a Central Pacific effect. So then, okay, so there was some critics. As you've seen, it's only a 15 years time record that I used. So there were some concerns, of course. We had only one Eastern Pacific event, and then we had three Central Pacific events. So how can we be so sure that what we are characterizing is actually real or just representative of one event? So we repeated the analysis. I couldn't do it on the biology because the record was what it was at the time, 15 years. But on the physics, I could reproduce the analysis and start in 1979 when I started to have data from a reanalysis product. And so I repeated over 35 years. And when I did this analysis on 35 years, okay, I had only still two Eastern Pacific events through that entire 35 years. And I think I added something, maybe I had in total six or seven Central Pacific events. And what do you see between the two? Simply when you add more years, you increase the regions where you have a significant influence. But the patterns remain the same. So it gave us some confidence that the response that we were observing in the biology was actually probably quite correct, quite robust. Then the idea was to try to explain the changes in the biology based on changes in the physics and in the ocean variables. So I looked, as I showed before, influence on SST and also influence on sea surface height and wind. So here, again, probably with the projector you can't see so well, but you can see the regions where the wind vectors are actually significant. And so here you see this packing of warm water, and here you see the influence from both sides, very strong wind coming from both sides. And yeah, you see in the Indian Ocean very strong response. You see some kind of a formation of a gyre here and here as well. And you see very different response. Here you see lower sea level. So potentially you have potentially, I think you have a downwelling there, or upwelling. No, I think you have a downwelling. So you have a very, very different response. So this was a first evaluation. So then the idea was to validate a little bit those results. And so of course, there has been some other works that have been done on this. Especially from Gerhard et al. She has looked a lot in the equatorial region at the influence on chlorophyll of this different type of El Niño. And she looked at two specific events, a Central Pacific event in 2009-2010. And here she shows the anomaly for that particular event. And here at the bottom is the Eastern Pacific event of 1997-1998. And you see, so sea level anomalies are plotted. So here you have lower sea level anomalies, higher sea level anomalies, and here more in the central part. So this is associated to the region where you have packing of water, so it increases, it rises your sea level, and also it's warmer water, and it's occurring more here. And you have the wind vectors. And if we look in the signals that I obtained by using a regression analysis, so here I plot only the vectors that are significant. Here it's the anomaly, so we see any vectors. It just tells you what's happening at for those years. But we see that we have the vector going in the same directions. And here is the same. So it gave us some confidence in the work that we were doing. Okay, then if we try to summarize a little bit all this information, so maybe you've been hopefully not too confused, but here I show you only the pixels that showed a significant influence of the different type of El Niño, and the direction of the primary production, whether it increased or decreased. So if it decreased, it was in blue, it's in blue, and if it increased, it's in red. And so then the idea was to try to explain why we had an increase or a decrease. So what we did first is we characterized the regions of the ocean that were more light limited or nutrient limited. So this is not necessarily new work. This has been done by other authors, but we just did the analysis as well to include in the paper. So we did a regression between chlorophyll concentration and PAR, so photosynthetically available radiations over the period of CWIF and MODIS for the PAR, and chlorophyll we use CCI data. And what we see is that at higher latitude we have a positive correlation. So meaning that when we have enhanced power availability, so we have more light availability, then we have enhanced chlorophyll concentration. While at in the tropics and subtropics, low and mid latitudes, we looked at the correlation between chlorophyll and the depth of the mixed layer. And there we found positive correlation between MLD and chlorophyll, meaning that when we have deeper mixed layer depths, we have more mixing, we get more nutrients, and this is when we have enhanced chlorophyll concentration. So, very simply, we characterize a region that would be more light limited and region that would be more nutrient limited. Of course, this is simple, there are other influences. What you notice here in those correlations is very weak correlation in the central, in the equatorial regions. I try to explain this by simply, first here you see it's inverse, the correlation compared to the rest of the area. And if we look here at the availability of macronutrients, so nitrates, so it's just an annual mean for nitrate from the World Ocean Atlas. And here you see that you have a relatively high availability of nitrates. In the tropics and subtropics, you have very low concentration, so you are nutrient limited. But in that region here, I don't know if you can see, you don't have such limitation in nitrates. And so this could be potentially why we don't get a similar relationship. So it could be limited, but not by macronutrient, but maybe by trace nutrients. And we also observe that this region where we have low correlation, it's also the region where we have the strongest zonal surface current, meaning that in this region, potentially horizontal advection might play a very important role. So it would not just be vertical mixing enhancing the chlorophyll or decreasing the chlorophyll. It could also be very strong horizontal advection. So we have now characterized a region that might be more nutrient or light limited. And so I just highlighted simply or circle or contoured regions where the primary production, for instance, was enhanced due to enhanced nutrient concentration, and a region where the phytoplankton decreased, and this was most likely associated with a decrease in nutrient availability. And at higher latitude, then it's more light limited. So in that region, we had increase in primary production associated with enhanced light availability. So potentially simply more stratification and for a longer period, and then you get maybe more light availability. So you get more primary production. Okay, so and in some regions, for instance here, it's a little bit more complex as well as in some basins here. So you might also have changes in precipitation, so it might change your river input. And sometimes also, like in Indonesia during El Nino, especially Eastern Pacific El Nino in 1997, you get more fires, unfortunately, and you get more smoke from these fires that will actually deposit dust at the surface of the ocean. So during that particular event, you actually have fertilization from below because you have enhanced upwelling. You see you have a strong negative SST anomaly. And you have also fertilization from above through dust deposition from the fires. And so here, this enhanced chlorophyll or primary production is really associated with availability of nutrients from different sources. Okay, we've produced this atlas of impact of different type of El Nino. So actually, the interpretation of the dominant mechanism we propose here a quite simple analysis, but we're aware that it can vary a lot depending on different, whether it's horizontal or vertical advection, whether it's associated with stratification, wind, atmospheric dust deposition, or riverine input. I don't mention here, but of course it will change with sea ice availability at higher latitude. And actually one of the conclusions was that we showed that the influence can be perceived globally. but we found that about 60% of the total affected area were located in the tropics and subtropics, and the remaining 33% were at higher latitude. So some implication in terms of carbon cycle. So during Eastern Pacific El Niño, we found very large regional variability. We got a decrease of minus 56 teragrams of carbon per year. In the tropical Eastern Pacific Ocean, minus 82 teragrams of carbon per year in the Western Indian Ocean. So these are these big regions. And an increase in the Eastern Indian Ocean of plus 13 teragrams of carbon per year. So these are just some examples. And during the Central Pacific El Niño, we get a large decrease of minus 68 teragrams of carbon per year in this region of the tropical Pacific, and minus 10 teragrams of carbon per year in the Central Atlantic regions. So these are some examples of the implication for the carbon cycle. In terms of implication for fisheries, so I will come back to my atlas, but first I would like to go through an example of changes in diatom abundance of the coast, the west coast of South America. And we see here December 1997, we had a decrease in diatom abundance in that region, and we had very high sea surface temperature. While in December 2000, we actually had a higher diatom abundance and a cooler sea surface temperature in that region. So we've seen you've seen this figure a few times, this trophic chain a few times during the week. But so as to how, when you don't have any diatoms, maybe you have more flagellates, and this can favor maybe small copepods and sardines. And when you have larger phytoplankton, such as diatoms, then you might favor larger copepods and anchovies. So this is some examples. And so here is another example from Tom Jackson, who gave several presentations over the past few days. So he looked at the relationship between the changes in diatom abundance and the anchovy catch in the next year. And what he found is that he had a complete collapse in anchovies in 1997, when it was a very strong El Niño event. Eastern Pacific El Niño, but when we had Central Pacific El Niño, so still an El Niño, but different type, such as in 2002 and 2004, well, they didn't observe such a collapse in the anchovy fisheries. And actually, if you look at the map of impact, you find that indeed you had a very large decrease in phytoplankton during the Eastern Pacific event. But during the Central Pacific event, you don't get such a large decrease in phytoplankton. And actually, in some region, you might even get an increase in phytoplankton. So these maps are actually very useful to inform and to help us understand that different types of El Niño will have different impacts. And of course, this is looking at extremes. Every El Niño event is different. So you might not be able to classify it as a Central Pacific event or Eastern Pacific event. But still, I mean, this is going towards having a little bit more information on what's happening. Okay, do I still have time or am I really late? I don't know, I'm supposed to finish. 5:30. Yeah, but still.
We're supposed to finish at 3:15.
3:15. Ah, so I'm really over time, so nobody's complaining. Maybe I saw you all sleeping. Or so maybe. So okay, I'll go quickly. Maybe I'll skip this. I just want to mention, so changing a little bit the subject, before I left, I wanted to show these next two slides about uncertainty in ocean color observation. So we've talked about it over the past few days. We've given some examples. And I thought it was nice to actually get you to this slide. So what is available when you download an ocean color CCI file of chlorophyll? It's not just chlorophyll that comes. You can get access to the reflectance. You can get access to various products. And one of the available products is an estimate of the bias and the root mean square error. Okay, so personally, I'm not an expert into this, so I struggled a lot the very first time that I decided to work with this data to actually get an error bar on my chlorophyll estimates that I was going to show, that I show on my maps. So simply, if you take the bias and RMS at 4 kilometers resolution, when you do a spatial binning to 1 degree, then here you will see in the PowerPoint, this is a simple equation that you can apply to calculate to the bias when you do a bin to 1 degree, and the RMS when you do a bin to 1 degree. And similar, when you do a temporal binning, let's say you make your own composites from daily observations and you want to create 8-day composites. Again, you can calculate the bias and the root mean square error. So it's quite simple. And then when you want to get to the standard deviation, so it's actually provided in low chlorophyll concentration. And then when you want to get to the standard deviation, you can estimate the difference, so the square difference between the root mean square and the bias. And you can get a value of standard deviation. So I will provide this slide. I think it's correct, Shuba, or it should be. And so this is, for instance, what I used in my paper to get little error bars when I looked at the changes in chlorophyll A versus different value for the El Niño index. But I mean, now with the product of CCI, you can get such error bars. And I think this is very, very useful thing to show. Yeah, it's really, yeah, it's very strong, really good. So it's worth spending a little bit of time on the math and to try to get it right and to express it in something that you can understand, in a measure that you can understand, or you can plot. Okay, so I had two examples on the Arctic Ocean, because I know that not all of you are interested in the tropics, so I won't go into details into it like I did for the El Niño and the Indian Ocean Dipole. So very shortly, I have 3 slides on this. So it's just to show you, so this is the Arctic Ocean. So we are changing totally subject. So it's ice concentration here. It's a trend between 1979 to 2015. So it's worked by Matti Caru, 2016, quite recent. And so this for months of June and August, and this is changes in net primary production over a slightly shorter time period. So you see that the region where you have reduction in ice concentration usually coincide quite well with a region where you have enhanced net primary production. For the month of June, it's less clear in August. It doesn't work so well, but okay. So these are some examples of results. Here he looked at changes in phenology, so both the phenology in the timing of the ice retreat and the phenology in the timing of the bloom of the phytoplankton. And so here is the initiation, so when the open water becomes available from 1978 till 2013. And we see that they become available 4.5 days earlier nowadays compared to 1978. And the ice tend to reform and close this open water a little bit later nowadays. About plus 1.4 day per year, so it's quite a lot actually. Yeah, so if you have I don't know how many years now. So 1978, so we have 30 years. Am I correct? Yes. So you do almost 5 times 30 is quite a few more days. So it's like almost 150 days more. Of open water. The water is the open water comes 150 days earlier than in 1958. It's huge. Okay, and so this is the changes in terms of timing of initiation of the phytoplankton bloom. So about minus 3 days per year. Okay, and not so much changes in terms of the termination of the bloom. Okay, here is another example, still for the Arctic, paper by Mathieu Ardina. So he looked at actually something that I presented to you a few days ago, whether you have two blooms or a single bloom event, or whether you have no bloom. in some regions of the Arctic. So in blue, it's where he couldn't detect a any bloom. In green is where he could only detect one bloom, and in red it's where he could detect two peaks per year. And here you see how it varies latitudinally as you go towards the pole. So as you go towards the pole, you tend to move towards a more, you have a lot of two blooms at lower latitude, and as you move towards the pole, you tend to go towards more of a single bloom or no blooms. And here he looked at changes over a different time period, so 1999 to 2001, when he had only no peak, where he had one bloom and where he had two bloom. So you see from 1991 to 2001 here, then 2002, 2006, and 2007 till 2012. So you get an increase in the two blooms, number of two blooms, the regions where you can observe two blooms. And here is the same, but spatially. Okay, so my last two slides of conclusion. So potential responses of the marine ecosystem to a changing climate. So we see that we might have changes in the total amount of phytoplankton, so chlorophyll concentration changes, changes in the community structure, changes in other variables, so looking at absorption and scattering relative to chlorophyllae, and the phenological changes. And here are some examples, further conclusions, but I won't read them. I will leave it here. Thank you very much for having listened. Thank you. Okay.